So I wasn't really upset because I wasn't a person that was looking forward to being a pilot or flying or anything else. It was just that come wartime, I had to do it. So I decided, well, what's going to happen now? And they told me that I could either go to officers training school and be on the ground, or if I wanted, I could fly, but I'd have to go to aircraft mechanic school and gunnery school. So I chose that, and I went to Harlingen. No, I went to Keesler Field, Mississippi.
And John, I'm going to move us along a little bit. You went through a series of schools, and you finally became a full-fledged
Flight
engineer
engineer.
and
Yeah.
a gunner,
Right.
firing the 50 caliber machine guns.
Machine guns, yeah.
So that
Yeah.
qualified you to become a crew member of a B-24.
Right.
Four-engine, 10-man crew.
Right.
Now, you hook up with your crew, and you all meet for the first time, and that was in, where did you meet your crew, all 10 of you?
Well, we met at Boise, Idaho.
Boise, Idaho. And
Yeah.
from there, you flew to San Francisco.
No, I went to Tonopah, Nevada.
Okay. Oh, that's
And
where you.
at Tonopah, Nevada, we started training for bomb runs over the desert. And we did that for about 2 weeks, maybe 3 weeks. And then we were transferred to the West Coast, to San
And
Francisco.
then eventually
But
to.
that was where we were going to take off for
Hawaiian Islands.
Hawaiian Islands.
Well, eventually you land with your crew at Hickam Field in Hawaii.
Right.
And you actually get your airplane right out of the crate, so to speak. And the name of it was the, what was the name of the aircraft?
Madam Pele.
Madam Pele. Madam
Yeah.
Pele is who?
She's the fire goddess of Hawaii.
Okay. And that was actually monies that was raised by the children. They made a contribution to the
Right.
purchase of this aircraft, so they were
Right.
part of it all, and there was a lot of
Right.
publicity. I read some of your write-ups about this particular event.
And some of the write-ups were in the Honolulu newspaper.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, while you're in Hawaii, you go out and do five missions, patrol
Right.
missions.
Right.
And on one of those missions, it just kind of shows how fate intervenes. Your crew was down for the day,
Right.
and another crew needed a navigator.
Navigator.
So they said, look, you're not doing anything today. Why don't you join our crew for this particular patrol mission?
Right.
And what was his name, the navigator?
His name was Johnson Brenneman.
From Bar Harbor?
He was from Bar Harbor, Maine. And he took over as the navigator for that flight. And we never heard from them again. In other words, they either went down with malfunction the plane, or they were shot down or something,
The
one or
plane was
another.
just
But
missing in action.
we never
The
heard from them
crew,
again.
it was just, but just that one day that it was just fate
Right,
that.
yeah.
After you finish your five missions, your patrol missions, you now go to Kwajalein, which is
Kwajalein, yeah.
Kwajalein. And that's about 2,100 miles from
From
Hawaii.
Hawaii,
And
yeah.
this is where you're going to. This is
This
your.
is where we're going to start our bombing missions,
And
combat missions.
And you all live in these large tents. There was no, you know, no barracks. There was
no
tents. Was just, everything was out. Everything is outside.
Right,
you're living
right.
in big these 10-man tents and eating outside. And but it was secure. The Marines had taken Kwajalein, and there was an air base there. And we were going across the Pacific and these islands.
Right.
And your mission was to be a flight engineer and a top gunner on the B-24.
Right.
You know, I'd like to take a moment to talk a little bit about what life was out flying these missions. When you'd go out and you'd be up 20,000 feet.
Right.
It is, I don't know how many degrees below zero, 20 degrees below zero, maybe 30 degrees, some.
But horrific. Don't forget, we weren't up 20,000 feet too long, because as we went out to the target, we traveled about 10,000. Then when we started getting close, then the pilot climbed to the 20,000. All right, we went through our bomb run on 20,000 feet. Then after the bombs were dropped, then we peeled off and we went back down to 10,000 feet again. So we weren't up there for a real long time, but it was very, very cold.
It was these bomb runs were hours and hours over open water.
Right.
And there was no place to land. You don't land in the Pacific. The Pacific is an awfully big place.
That's right.
So one of your major concerns had to be the engine going.
Yeah.
Just mechanical.
Right.
And then, of course, when you got to the target, you had anti-aircraft.
Right.
And once that broke off, you had now fighters coming in.
We left the target, then the fighters would come in, and they'd follow us for probably half an hour before they could go back to their base again.
One of the events you talked about is you saw some white powdery thing on you after one of the missions.
Oh, yeah.
And after you landed, they determined what happened?
Well, there was a hole in the plexiglass in front of me, and there was another hole in back. So the crew chief took a broom and put it through the hole and out the other hole, and it was about 3 inches from my face. That's where the shrapnel
just flew through.
And
if you were 3 inches that way instead of that way,
right? If I had moved over like this,
we may not have had. This
I wouldn't be here today.
And you also, there was a particular event that you, when you moved from Kwajalein to Guam, you went on one mission to do a combat mission over Guam, where you got the crew got a Distinguished Flying Cross.
Right.
There was fighter planes, there was... it was a horrific battle.
That was over Saipan.
Over Saipan. You were over Saipan.
Yeah.
And you had 40 missions.
Right.
40 missions. That's just, every time you'd go up, you never knew whether you were going to come back.
That's right.
And you said you kept a $10 bill in your
jacket pocket. And that stayed there for the whole...
For the whole
40 missions.
40 missions. I mean, that's when you think of that, because I mean, every flight went out, somebody might not be coming back.
Right.
You think what the odds are? They're long odds. I mean, the air war. We lose track of how many people and planes were lost.
Right,
and
right.
You saw even when they were hitting parachute out, you witnessed Japanese aircraft strafing these pilots.
Parachutes
coming down,
yeah. For planes that were knocked down, our planes, and they'd be strafing the parachutists.
Well,
but we couldn't do anything about it.
Well, John, you got various campaign managers, a good conduct ribbon, Air Medal with two oak leaf clusters, the Distinguished Flying Cross, which was awarded for extraordinary heroism in military action against an armed enemy, and honorable discharge. That was, in my mind, you are a hero. after this, you went back, you finished the 40 missions, and you said that you all had a big party, mm-hmm. and you probably are saving a beer, and you just guys went, had a deservedly good time.
Oh, yeah.
And then your military career, you finished your missions, you were back to Hawaii, and then they asked you whether or not you wanted to fly back, or take a ship back to the United States, and you chose...
Right, I chose the ship.
Because?
Well, because I figured I flew 40 missions, and I was pretty lucky to survive. And I said, gee, if I take a plane back, what if something goes wrong with the plane, and it goes down?
That would have been... Well, so you made the right choice. If you're going down with a life boat.
Yeah, so we decided to go by boat.
And then you wound up in
Chanute Field, Illinois.
And yeah. one morning you woke up and heard about an atomic bomb
being dropped on Hiroshima.
And 3 days later, Nagasaki.
Yeah.
Your war was over. They offered you whether you want to go back to Fort Devens or you want to get discharged right there.
Right, right.
You chose to be discharged right there.
Right there.
And off on a train you went.
And I went home.
Back to the gentleman. That must have been one happy day that you got back.
Right.
You then, this was 1945, and you were going to take some time off. It was a 52-20 club that they had, so you took
right.
some time off
took
before
time
you
off.
Went to work. And then you had a good time for a while, like
right.
a lot of returning veterans.
Right, yeah.
But then you went to work, and you spent a lifetime... It's basically working in with your hands as a painting, electrostatic
right,
painting.
Right, right.
But on a lucky day in 1948, you met and married Libra Abruzzi, who you met while working in Waltham.
Right,
she
right.
worked for the Waltham
Watch
Company,
yeah.
and you
yeah.
were working there.
Mm-hmm.
And in 1948, you marry Libra.
Right.
And then you have three children.
Right.
The oldest, John, Patricia, Stephen.
Right.
In 1960, you moved from Waltham to Watertown. And you have six grandchildren.
Six grandchildren, yeah.
And then yeah. in 1983, your beloved wife, Libra, lost her battle with cancer.
Right.
In 1985, you retired. You are staying active. You tell you multiple things you do, bingo, yeah. the 440 and so forth. And it's been a fascinating story. You have lived a fascinating life, Papa John. Mm-hmm. I'd like to take a few moments and ask you mm-hmm. to dedicate your story, your life story, your veteran story to
my wife, Libra. I'd like to dedicate this story to her. She was a great person, and she loved life, and we went on a lot of vacations together after the kids grew up. And I was always thankful for that we had a chance to do that. We come back from Greece, and that's when we found out that she had this disease. And
you lost her in 19...
She left us in, that was 78. And then in 83, she died. So I had a wicked 5 years.
Papa John, thank you for sharing your story, your life story, your veteran story.
Thank you for having me here.
And thank you for being with us.
Yeah.
And we will see you next time.
Yep.